إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. عباد الله، أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله عز وجل فقد فاز المتقون. وأذكركم ونفسي بقول الله تبارك وتعالى: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. Dear Muslims, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who made us free, free with him, free with Islam. You remember with me how we lived last Friday with example of true believers who believed in the true meaning of freedom. And you remember with me when the whole society wanted only a word from the Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and he didn't give it to them. And he was ready to go through any difficulty, even death. And he won, because he was truthful in his faith. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رِجَالٌ صَدَقُوا مَا عَاهَدُ اللَّهَ عَلَيْهِ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ قَضَى نَحْبَهُ وَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ يَنْتَذِرُ وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. Among the believers, there are people who were truthful in what they promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with, in their oath. And some of them died on that. And some of them are still on the way, but they will never change. And we learned how brave he was and what made him brave, because he was holding to the rock of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was holding up to the truth. And Abdullah bin Abbas radiallahu anhu used to say, صاحب المعروف لا يقع وإذا وقع وجد له متكعا. The truthful person, anyone who holds on to the truth, you will never fall down. And if you fall down, you will be able to stand up again. And the Imam was like that. He taught us what is the meaning of freedom, which we want to learn today, inshallah, from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and from the teaching of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam. And before we go into that, maybe you read day before yesterday about what has been said again about the women right in Islam. But I think we are used to it. And we have been told in the Holy Quran, لَنْ يَضُرُّوكُمْ إِلَّا أَذَى. They cannot harm you. It is only annoying. With whatever you say, simply when a proper organization or government call you and ask you to confirm, is it true that is how Islam divide the provision among the families? Just to confirm. And you put your hand in the Quran and say that is the truth. And I did. And I explained that in one of these cases, there will be a time when a female in Islam is surrounded by men. And always it is that man's responsibility to make sure that female is fully covered and protected. It's one of the cases when one boy will take the two shares for a girl. And some cases, the girl will take the whole lot. And some cases, she will take half. And some cases, she will take two thirds. But they will not explain all of this. They just pick up people who are hungry for bad news. To them it is. People who will never know anything about Islam because they don't want to. They are vampires of faith. And they hang for something like that, talk from behind, will never have or be honest enough to come to Muslim people who know Islam and sit and discuss and say, we want to send this out to the public, so what is the real process in Islam about this issue? They will never do that because they are scared. Scared of what? The truth. And they will always keep talking behind the curtain. But as Muslims, we know that it will happen forever because Shaitan will never die until the judgment day. And we should never die. And if we do, our children will carry on this job to live and die for Islam. But it's very important for us to know that how to act, not to react. We are not meant to react. How to act when things like this is happening. We need to know how to live and hold on together. And we should not, because sometimes people, straight away, they will leave the media and start attacking Muslims some way. Why did he do that? Or why did she say that? But we know that they didn't do, they didn't say. But this is what the media wants the people to click in their mind. See, we told you. See how much they give. What women were in the Islamic way. They will go and doing that because they have nothing better to offer. And when you are filthy or bad, only that thing will come out of you. And we all know that. We all are human who understand. It is so bad. After more than 1,500 years, there are still people in this 21st century who still don't understand what Islam means when it says this and that, because they don't want to. But it's not a problem. Talks will go on anyway, inshallah, about this topic. And those people who really want to know the Islamic perspective, they will come and listen. But the evil will keep on doing that to pollute the truth about Islam because they don't want the people to know the truth. But we believe the Australian people and the whole world people, they are free enough to go out there and go to the Muslims who really know what is Islam to know the truth if they're looking for a proper education. So we will never be slaves. Ali bin Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, used to say to his sons, do not be a slave to someone because Allah made you free. So do not be a slave to someone. And you may be a slave how? When you don't know who you are and what is happening. So it's very important for everyone to be aware and come to know that whatever they say, they will keep on saying that forever. But we believe the Australian people and the rest of the world are mature enough to go to the right sources to look for the truth if they really want it. So we should not worry anymore about the media. We just need to know how to live together and really sort our things out and say they cannot use that against us, against each other. So we go back to the freedom in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us indication about the meaning of the freedom. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَوَفَّاهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا فِي مَا كُنْتُمْ قَالُوا كُنَّا مُسْتَضْعَفِينَ فِي الْأَرْضِ قَالَ أَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا. Some people in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the judgment day, and they failed to live like Muslims. And their excuse is that where we used to live, we had no chance to practice our Islam. And the question to them was that the only place where you can survive? How come you didn't go somewhere else where you can be free to practice your deen and your way of life? So it is not an excuse. Even if we have to suffer to leave some places, but we have to live in our freedom. And the real freedom for a believer is when we are able to be what we want to be as Muslims. And in a place like Australia, we can be that. There will be harm from people who are irresponsible, people who are disloyal and dishonest, who want to mix things together up. But that's not only to the Muslims mainly, to any human with dignity. And when we go back into the history, we read a lot of examples. How wrong has been done to some people, not because they were Muslims, but because they were following the truth, and because they used to be just and fair. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding the believers that you are born with your freedom. Reminding the non-believers that you are born with your freedom. Even when you decide to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you do that freely. La ikraha fi din. Qattabayyana ar-rushdu min al-ghayb. Beliefs are not to be imposed on people. The truth should be clarified from the false. And in the line of the freedom, we want to go through some of the sayings. What happens when you're looking for your freedom? And the prince of poetry, which we can say Ahmad Shawki, who used to say, defining the real freedom, قَيَّدَ الْحُرُّ نَفْسَهُ بِهُدَاهُ وَأَبَى فِي الْحَيَاةِ قَيْدَ سِوَاهُ. The real free human being is the one who will limit his freedom within the morality and within the guidance and the dignity. Not to be free to follow his desire, not like that. And then we start to say, Al-Hurriyatu wama hiya. What is freedom? Al-Humayra'ul Ghaliya. Fitnatul Qurunil Khaliya. Wa Tulbatul Nufusil Aliya. That one has to explain. It is something when you look for it, you may end up getting your hands red with what? With blood. It will may cost you even your life. And the history of colonialism has shown the world this meaning. غذاء الطبائع ومادة الشرائع وأم الوسائل والذرائع بيت العلم بنت العلم إذا تم والخلق إذا تم وربيبة الصبر الجميل والعمل الجبر الجهل يعدها والفرقة تبعدها والصغائر تفسدها تكبيرة الوجود في أذن المولود وتحية الدنيا له إذا وصل وصيحة الحياة به إذا نصل هاتف من السماء يقول له يا ابن آدم حسبك من الأسماء عبد الله وسيد العالم. You need only two names on this earth. And what is that? I'm the servant of Allah and I'm the master of the universe. In another word, the caretaker. It will be long to explain about it, but reminding us, everybody looking for their freedom. And the result of freedom, you will come to know the real human beings. And the story of Thumama ibn Affan, radiallahu anhu, showing us what is the result that will come out of freedom. The man who was one of the enemies of the Messenger of Islam and the Messenger of Islam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To the extent that the Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam made dua, oh Allah, make me get hold of Thumama one day. And we know that when the Prophet makes dua, it is answered. The distance, there is no distance between dua of a Prophet and the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The way we remember last Friday when Ali ibn al-Hussein, when he said, when he was asked, what is the distance between the arsh and the air? And he said, da'watu mustajaba. It is a dua that heard by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is the only distance. So Thumama being captured by the Muslims and was brought to the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam, and they didn't know who he was. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam said to them, do you know who you get hold of? That is Thumama ibn Athan. That is him. And he said to the Sahaba, treat him very well. Tie him up in the masjid. In another word, we say, the prisoner in the masjid. And why the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did that? Not for Thumama to stay in the masjid a few days and see how bad the Muslims are, how frequent they fight and argue for no reason in the masjid, how much they hate one another or disrespect each other, but to see the opposite. And Thumama had the honor to leave with the Muslims for 3 days in Damascus, under the supervision of the leader and the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. And he saw the leader and the Ma'mumin. And straight away, his heart went into sujood. Just seeing the Muslims, how they pray, how they treat each other, and how they love each other, and how they respect each other, and how kind they are. His heart went to sujood, but he kept it to himself. And when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam went to him and said to him, Malaka ya Thumama, what is the matter with you, Thumama? Did you feel that Allah made me get hold of you? And he said, yes. And then he said, if you kill me, I deserve that. I killed many Muslims. If you pardon me, I will be so thankful to you. And if you want me to pay money for my life, I will do it. That was his answer for the 3 days. Every time the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam asked him. And after 3 days, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said to him, you gave me 3 options to do with you, and you know it. To kill you, or take your money, or pardon you and let you go. I will not kill you, I will not take your money, I will let you go. And he left him, and he left. In a very slow footsteps, while he was having internal revolution, an internal self-conversation, where am I going? Where else on earth you can get a leader like him? And Ma'mumin like those people. Our world is bankrupt of this type of leadership and Ma'mumin. So he went back to that. He went away and he had shower. And he came back to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And he said to him, Ya Muhammad, I will tell you who I was and who I am now. Laqad kuntu wa ma ala wajhi al-ardi wajhun abqada ilayya min wajhi wa ma ala wajhi al-ardi deenun abqada ilayya min deenik wa ma ala wajhi al-ardi baladun abqada ilayya min baladik. This is how I was. I used to be someone that there is no face on the face of the earth I hate the most more than you. There is no religion on earth I hated the most more than Islam. There is no town on earth I hated the most more than your town. This is how I was. But now I'm different. I'm the new Thumama. Now I am someone who loves you the most. I love your face. I love being with you and wherever you are. And I love Islam, the only religion. There is none. And I love this town, the best town to my heart. And then he said, Ya Rasulullah, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu annaka Rasulullah. Why he did that? After his freedom to put the rocks in the mouth of those who still yelling today, saying that Islam is spread by sword. It didn't. If you don't now ask Thumama, what made you a Muslim? The Muslim way of life. And the kindness and the mercy attitude, merciful attitude of their leader, Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. He brought life into me. That's what made me a Muslim, not the sword. A sword cannot make a human a Muslim unless that human have no dignity. Even if they have no faith, they believe that I'm a free human, I have dignity, I will not live on fear. And that is what happens when you deal with anyone, even if they have no belief at all. But they know that I'm a human being, I will not live on my knees. I'm ready to die on my feet. Nothing to do only with the believers in Islam more fair, because they have hope in God, hope in dunya and the akhirah. So a true believer never dies. And death is no more than the pathway or the corridor to go into the real life, the judgment day. But they will die with their dignity. That's how they will become a Muslim. After he won his freedom, he was told to go and you are free. And he realized the real free people are those who live under the faith, under the truth. And the same thing reminds us when Socrates, when he was tried and he was given the date when he will die, and they used to give a very deadly poison to those who are to be killed, and they have to drink it and die. And his students could bribe the guards, and they went to him and they said to him, look, you can run away. You can run away. We bribed the guards and we made it. And then he was disappointed. What do you mean run away? You mean I ran from death to life. What is the meaning of life to you? To me, the only meaning of life is when I do the right thing. The truth is my life. And if you run away from the truth, you are already dead. Good people never die. That's when he declared war on all the gods on the mountain of Olympic in Athens. And he was sentenced to death because he declared war on the gods. But what was he against? Against these man-made gods fighting each other like children. He didn't declare war on the faith, but on the false gods. He was towards the truth, if he had a chance to be. So to believe in the very true one God. But he said, I will not run away. And then they asked him, how you want us to bury you when you die? He says, it's up to you. You will only deal with my body, but my soul will go somewhere else better. It means he was really on his way, looking for the truth, looking for Islam. But the environment didn't allow him. The environment was bankrupt from the people who know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the real freedom is really when we get this meaning in our life. Never to give up, because Islam is the only ism that will stay. Any other ism will die. And the Holy Quran confirmed that. لِيُذْهِرَهُ عَلَى الدِّينِ كُلِّ. So we should remain and wait for that day. If we could not, we pass on the same will to our children that you don't be afraid if you are doing the right thing. And there is nothing can really harm you. We will go through the test, but remember, we have to go through that to prove that we believe. And many examples about the meaning of the true freedom. The magician who used to worship Fir'aun for so long, once they became Muslims, what happened? They used to be in fear, afraid of a man like them, Fir'aun, in the absence of the true freedom, which is a faith. But once they realized the truth with Musa alayhi salam, they believed. And Fir'aun threatened them, لَوْ صَلِّبَنَّكُمْ فِي جُذُوءِ النَّخْلِ لَوْ قَطِعَنَّ أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ وَلَأُصَلِّبَنَّكُمْ فِي جُذُوءِ النَّخْلِ وَلَتَعْلَمُنَّ أَيُّنَا أَشَدُّ عَذَابًا وَأَبْقَى. He threatened them, I will chop off your hands and legs and crucify you on the palm trees, and you will see whose punishment is more severe, mine or Musa's God, and you will see who will stay and live forever, me or Musa's God. That is how ignorant he was. And the magician answered, لَنْ نُؤْثِرَكَ عَلَى مَا جَاءَنَا مِنَ الْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالَّذِي فَطَرَنَا فَقْدِ مَا أَنْتَ قَوْتْ إِنَّمَا تَقْدِي هَذِهِ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا. We came to know the truth. There is nothing you can do to us anymore. All you can do, take our body and eat us alive if you want. But we know the truth, and we will never ever prevail you on the truth anymore. We'll go to try. This is our faith. Now we are free. This is the true meaning of the freedom. And there is no point in being alive if we have nothing in our life to be ready to live and die for. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us on the judgment day, oh my servant. This is to do with what happened around the world for looking for the freedom. And I believe we all know what is happening around the world now. And now, one of our Muslim countries is going through this test. It is Syria. And when I talk about Syria, I'm full of emotions because it is my hometown, I can say. I saw the world through Syria. My eyes opened through Syria. The people in Syria who used to hit me, and they remind us the will of the Prophet Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, when he told the Sahaba and the Arabs, many people will become Muslims and they will come to you to learn about their deen. فَاسْتَوْسُوا بِهِمْ خَيْرًا. Look after them very well. And I saw that with my eyes, how the scholars in Syria used to treat the children from Albania, from Turkey, from Germany, from Africa. So remember, this is what the Prophet spoke about. They came here from Africa and everywhere, want to learn their deen. It's very hard to say. And our people now going and becoming victims of war and civil fight, which is the worst to happen to any nation. If somebody asks invade our country, we are ready to fight to death because we know we are doing the right things. But how can I fight my own people? You never win that fight. And this test now, it is in Syria. We don't know what to do, but we don't fail to make dua for the people of Syria to come into tranquility and salam, inshallah, the way it was. There are so many things involved, internally and externally. It is a time of the fitna. Who is doing what? But we remember, إِلَىٰ دَيَّانِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ نَمْدِي وَعِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَجْتَمِعُ الْخُسُومُ. We all will go back to Allah one day, and He will tell us who was right and who was wrong. We pray for the peace for this place and any other Muslim countries. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring the aman and the tranquility and the peace to the heart of all the believers and the non-believers as human beings. We deserve to live in peace. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله ثم الحمد لله الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. عباد الله، قال تعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اجعل سريرتنا خيرا من علانيتنا واجعل علانيتنا صالحة. اللهم أعنا على ذكرك وشكرك وحسن عبادتك. اللهم أحسن ختامنا وأخرجنا من الدنيا مسلمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. وأقم الصلاة.